Thank you. Chapel. We are delighted that you're with us. I see many guests with us tonight. We hope that you'll feel at home here tonight. And we want to worship Jesus together, right? It was a little weak, but hopefully, I hope you meant that. And maybe the Sunday afternoon nap hadn't worn off yet. But we're here to worship Jesus tonight, right?
Amen.
He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we want to give him glory and honor. And it is a delight to have the Hope Sound Bible College choir with us. And they're going to be ministering to us in song tonight. We've just been looking forward to this for some time. In fact, we've been looking forward to this service for well over a year. Because a year ago, they were booked to be here, and the bus broke down, and we had a wonderful quartet service instead of a choir. But we've been anxious to have the choir for some time, and so we're delighted that they made it. It's good to have Paul Stettler here. He's no stranger to these parts, and public relations director there. And we know and love Paul. And I appreciate him when he's here tonight. And then, of course, the cases, Phil and Carla. And Carla's at the keys over here. And Phil drives a big bus. And appreciate them being here. And Lucas and Lena Ryder are with us, the director. And this makes me feel a little bit old because Lucas was reminding me when, upon arrival, he actually used the word that this is when we went to school together. He said, "Do you remember hazing me when I was a student, when we were students?" And I was like, "What? I never hazed anybody." But he remembered our choir tours back when we traveled, we had to do luggage checks. And apparently, I didn't remember I did this, but you're right. We had to check everybody's luggage to make sure we had to initial every, and when I say every, I mean every stitch of clothing that you were bringing on that tour. Ironically enough, this tie is old enough. This is one that I looked, yeah, I've got my initials. That's how old this tie is. And this is going back a few days. But anyhow, Lucas and I were contemporaries. He's actually, it made me feel really old when I realized the choir director at Hope Sound, he's younger than I am. We went to school together. It makes me feel, which just means Lucas is really young, is what that means, I guess. But not a finer man you're going to meet than Lucas Ryder, and glad to have his family with us. And so we are delighted that they're here tonight as well. Let's just join together in worship. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads right now, and let's pray. Let's just ask God to bless this time together. Lord Jesus, thank you for being with us. And Lord, we just pray, would you bless this gathering here tonight? I pray most of all, would you draw us closer to yourself? And every person here, Lord, may we hear your voice. May we worship you in spirit and in truth. I pray, would you bless and anoint the choir, Mr. Ryder, and Lord, all that's said and done, we want to bring glory and honor to you tonight. But we just pray, would you settle down among us and draw us close to yourself. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody said,
amen.
Amen. I'm going to turn it over to Reverend Stedler this time.
Thank you, Mike Mader. It is so good to be with you all tonight. I have been looking forward to coming to Thomasville. There's so many familiar faces, friendly faces here, and we're just excited to be here. I'm especially happy to see one of my favorite people in all the world, Miss Susie Cross. She is. Aren't you all happy to see Miss Susie Cross? I just love her to death. And she said she came early just so we could chat, so we did. So we might start some rumors over there, but that's okay. Oh my, so good to be with you tonight. More than anything, we want the Lord to be here, don't we? We want God's presence to be here because we do come to worship, not just verbally. That's not just a tradition, it's not just a cliche. We want to meet with God tonight. How many of you want to meet with God tonight? Amen. You know, he's promised to be here. It's just up to us. He'll be here whether we realize it or not. It's our task to get our mind and our heart in gear, to get our eyes and our ears open, to listen to the voice of the Spirit, to be able to sense his presence. He's already here. Let's get in tune with the Spirit, shall we? Why don't you stand together and let's sing that chorus, "Come Holy Spirit, I need you." As we're singing, the choir is coming to the platform. Let's sing it together.
Come Holy Spirit, I need you.
without the piano, let's sing.
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me.
Is this your prayer tonight? Assisted by Justin Ellison on the sound. You may be seated. Let's worship together.
They were worried about it.
Thank you. praise God this evening and thank Him for His help. Today, I thank Him for the message of that song, the truth of that song. Saving, helping, keeping, loving, and that just starts the list, right, of all the things that Jesus does for us. I praise His name tonight. I love it in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, where the Apostle Paul, who has credentials a mile long, says to the Corinthian believers, I come to you to preach one thing, and that's Jesus Christ. Because if we can be faithful to the message of Jesus Christ, that is the message of hope that this world needs. And I praise His name tonight. I'm so thankful for Jesus. I'm thankful for the change that He made in my life. I'm thankful for the change that I see Him making in the lives of these students, and I'm thankful for the change that I see Him making in the world around us. It makes my heart want to cry out with praise and say, praise you, Lord. Praise you, Christ, for what you have done and for what you are doing. Praise His name.
I see His wounds, His hands.
wonderful to be with you tonight. And the next song is Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, and it also has the solid rock mix with it. And I'm so thankful that in a world where we don't know what's going to happen next, we can turn our eyes upon Jesus, and he can be our solid rock. I'm thankful for the foundation that he's made in my life. I want to go all the way through with him, and I want my life to be an endless praise to him.
Thank you. foundation was popularity and all those things failed me, I finally realized and Jesus revealed to me that he is a firm foundation, an unwavering firm foundation. I just praise his name tonight. He is so worthy. There's a line in that song that says, I can stand secure. And as you listen to the words of these songs, I hope that would resonate with you. You can surely stand secure in the firm foundation of Jesus Christ tonight.
Thank you. in him throughout the course of time. So many still reach out to him with broken hearts and minds.
Every one of them will say, you know it's every death cry,
that Jesus never
thank you. Nothing can compare. Now let us adore.
Sing this chorus with me, will you?
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Let's sing it again. He is Lord.
Oh, He is Lord.
Because they want to have an impact for Christ, and I love that. So yes, it is a college, but it is a Bible college. What is the difference between a regular college and a Bible college? There is a huge difference, and it's all about the lens. You know, if I were to put on a pair of pink glasses, you would call me Elton John and think I was weird, and you would be right. But if I put on a pair of pink glasses, I would see the whole world differently, wouldn't I? Those white walls would suddenly become a shade of pink or lavender. And your face, if it's pale, might take on a rosy hue that it didn't have before. Because of the lens that I'm looking through. We want to give our young people a lens through which to view the world. And we want that lens to be the Bible. Amen?
Amen?
The Bible is God's inerrant, infallible, inspired word. We recently had an event on our campus called Inspired Exhibit, which brought a host of rare, ancient, and very valuable Bible manuscripts. We had Torah scrolls that would reach from the front wall all the way to the back wall of this church. Those scrolls were painstakingly handwritten. No letter could touch the other. If there were a certain number of mistakes, and I think it was 12 or less, they had to start all over. Even if they were toward the end, it took those scribes a year to make those scrolls. They had to stop, ceremonially cleanse themselves, and use a different pen to write the name of God. That's how seriously they took their task. That's awesome, isn't it? And you know, fast forwarding through history, there were people like William Tyndale, who literally gave their blood so that we could have a Bible. You know, in some of those mainline churches where I've done music in the past, after they read the scripture, the person reading will say, "The word of the Lord," and the crowd instantaneously responds, "Thanks be to God." I kind of like that tradition. Because for many years, it was in Latin, and nobody could understand it. Only rich people could pay someone, if they would go to the church, they could pay someone to come and read the Bible to them. And the price was astronomical, far out of reach for the common man. But then those people like John Wycliffe and William Tyndale and so many others sacrificed everything to make the Bible available so that they could understand it in their own language. No wonder their response at the reading of the scripture was, "Thanks be to God." Oh, that God would give us that kind of appreciation for His Word. We have great reverence for the Bible, and we want our students to look at their world, to look at our world through the lens of the Bible. It makes all the difference in the world. Do you realize that some of the most foolish, outrageous, absurd, ridiculous ideas circulating in our society have their source in places populated by the most highly educated among us? Has that ever occurred to you? The most educated, the most intelligent, the people with the highest IQs, the people with the biggest academic salaries have produced absurdity. And rather than learning stuff, we are unlearning stuff. We now can no longer tell whether we're a male or a female. A Supreme Court justice candidate was just asked in a public forum, "What is a woman?" And she could not define it. How can you defend the rights of a woman if you can't define a woman? Kind of crazy, isn't it? I don't mean to get political here tonight. But suffice it to say, our society is in trouble. And that trouble, in many senses, is finding its fountainhead in our academic institutions. There was never a day when Bible college was more important than today. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying you shouldn't go to a secular school. We drove over quite a number of bridges getting here. I hope that the person who designed every one of those bridges had a wonderful engineering degree. And they probably didn't get that at a Bible college, right? I hope if somebody's going to cut open my chest and tinker around in there, they're not going to be guessing. And they're not going to be saying, "Hey, look, when I push this, his leg twitches." No, that's not what you want to hear in the operating room, right? You hope somebody got a good medical degree, right? And they probably didn't get that at a Bible college. So there's a place for secular education. But friends, our young people need a foundation of faith. They need a foundation of faith that will enable them to go into those settings where they will learn under those professors, and they will have an answer to give every man and woman and child and human for the hope that lies within them, just as the Bible says. Amen? Amen. Of course, we train pastors and teachers and missionaries and Christian counselors and musicians, but I'm so proud of those young people, in addition to all of those, who have hit the pause button on their career, understanding that they could probably make more money if they would expedite their education going straight into the university system. They've hit the pause button and they've said, "I want to make sure I have a foundation for my faith. I want to make sure that I'm in the center of God's will." I love that. That's why we have a Bible college, to give them a lens. Now, when I was a kid, I was real chunky. I was pale, I had freckles, I had a gap in my front teeth, and I had bright red hair. It was tough. My dad, many of you know my dad, he and his brothers were very athletic. They were the trio to beat on the basketball court back in the day. My dad only had one boy, and he was kind of hoping that that boy would pick up the athletic torch. Not that I would be a professional baller, but that I would at least be able to, you know, make old dad proud on the basketball court and on the ball field. And he got me. chubby, red-headed, freckle-faced, gap-toothed pianist. But he was determined I was going to play sports. So at church camp, he would make me get out there, and I was very unwilling. And on this particular occasion at camp, I was out on the ball field. Somebody had given me a pair of cowboy boots, and I adored those cowboy boots. I stuffed my pants down inside them so I could show off the fancy stuff on the side long before that was a thing. And I even slept in it one night. I hate to admit that, but I didn't. On this occasion, Dad had pushed me out onto the ball field to play softball in my cowboy boots. And I got up to bat, and the one thing I had going for me was I was a lefty. And so, if you have a limited supply of athletes, you don't put your best players in right field, right? Because most people hit left-handed. So you put all your good players out in left field, and right field is where those people that got picked last get stuck, right? So that was in my favor. So I actually connected with the ball, believe it or not, and it went over the head of the first baseman, and it rolled out into right field. This was wonderful, because here I come, breathing heavy, chugging down the first baseline. Finally, I get there, and oh, I'm so relieved. And some jerk. Sorry, parents of small children, I shouldn't say that. Some very unkind person, probably a parent or a relative of someone on the opposing team, handed me the donut. Now, there's a reason why I was chunky. It's cause and effect, folks. I did not have a glandular problem. I was fat because I liked donuts. And so I chowed down on my donut, and I am totally engrossed on first base in my donut. And meanwhile, back at the game, somebody actually hit the ball and started running for first. Well, my dad was the third base coach, I believe, if I remember correctly. And he is over there jumping up and down saying, "Drop the donut and run!" You know what my problem was? My head wasn't in the game. My head was totally engrossed in that donut that I was chowing down on. And folks, we want to help our young people get their head in the game. We want them to understand the times, as the Bible says. We want them to be ready to give an answer to every man and woman who would ask of them, "What is the source of your hope? What is your faith all about?" We want them to get their head in the game. But you know why my head wasn't in the game? Because my heart wasn't in the game. The donut, yes, you're right. But my head wasn't in the game because my heart wasn't in the game. And so yes, we're an academic institution. We are concerned about the head. We want to teach them. We want to fill their heads with biblical knowledge as well as knowledge about math and science and English and all that good stuff. But as important, if not more so, we want to get their heart in the game. We want them to come face to face with the person of Jesus Christ, to know him personally and intimately, to be filled with the fullness of the Spirit, not to be content with just a one-time baptism of the Spirit, but to press on and be filled with all the fullness of God, as Paul says. Be filled with the fullness of his Spirit, to have a heart that is purified by faith, and to live a holy life. We want their heart to be in the game. Yes, we want to mold and shape their head. We want to appeal to their heart and see it transformed. But we also want to equip their hands. Because God didn't do these things for us just to hoard it to ourselves. God wants us to go out and serve his kingdom, to go out and touch people who are needy. And we want to train them how to use their hands for the kingdom of Christ. That's what we're about. Knowing Christ and making him known. That's our motto. That's who we are in a nutshell. And that's who we continue to be by God's grace. We have good days ahead. Things are looking up. Things are exciting. My dad is retiring. That's exciting. We've been wanting to get rid of him for a long time. Dad is retiring, and he is excited about it. He is looking forward. Mom isn't, but he is. No, I'm kidding. No, he really and truly is excited about retiring. And, of course, there are always those uncertainties associated with transitions. And we were thinking, wow, who's going to be the next person? Who does God have in mind for this position? And I am so happy that God has answered that. And God has done it in a way that I believe is beautiful. Matt Malloy is going to be our new president, and he will begin in the middle of this summer. He came and sat down in my office and shared a story with me. Now, Matt Malloy is not Barney Fife. He's not the kind of guy who has visions of grandeur about himself. He doesn't like to talk about himself. He's humble. He's very down to earth. And that's what makes this story so meaningful and so believable. He sat in my office and he said, "Paul, I was in Hope Sound over a year before your dad announced his retirement." He said, "I was the youth speaker for Seabreeze Camp. I was staying in the manor," that's the guest house right across from the tabernacle. There's a little wooden bridge that goes from the manor over to the parking lot where the church is. And he said, "I was standing on that bridge early in the morning having my devotions." And he said, "God spoke to me and God said, you are going to be the next president of Hope Sound." And he said, "I was flabbergasted." He said, "That is absurd." He said, "I'm too young, I'm too inexperienced, I'm not an alumnus. There is no way I would be chosen to be president of Hope Sound." But he said, "I couldn't get away from it." And he said, "The longer it went, the more frustrated I became because I thought, what is wrong with me? This is just crazy." But he said, "It extended on for weeks and weeks." And he said, "I couldn't sleep at night." And he said, "I finally had to get on my knees and pray a prayer of surrender to God, saying, Lord, I'll do whatever you ask." And he said, "After I prayed that prayer," he said, "the burden kind of lifted." And he said, "I wondered, well, maybe it's just like those kids at youth camp. You know, they go to the altar and say, okay, Lord, I'll go to Africa as a missionary. And then they never go to Africa as a missionary. They just had to make that sacrifice, you know, make that surrender." And he's like, maybe that's what this is. And he said, a few more weeks went by. And then he said, my pastor, who was a board member, pulled into the church parking lot and said, "Hop in the car and let's go for a ride." And he said, as we drove around town, he said, "Brother Stepper is retiring. And," he said, "I'm on the search committee and I want you to know that there's a list of about 40 names and your name is on there." He said, "To be honest, I don't think your name will be chosen." That was a great vote of confidence, right? He said, "I don't think your name will be chosen. But," he said, "I just wanted to let you know that your name is on there." Okay. Well, listen, the burden came back. And now I'm wrestling with this all over again. But I'm telling myself all the way along, this is absurd. This is never going to happen. He said, finally, several weeks later, he said, my pastor came back to me and said, "Matt Malloy, it's down to 4 names, and you're still on the list." And he said, "I've got to stop talking to you about this because of my position on the search committee." And he said, at that point, I thought, this can't be happening. Surely, of those 4 names, they're going to select someone else. He got a call from the chairman of the board, who lives not too far from here, Chairman Kaufman. And he said, "We'd like for you to come down for an interview." He said, "You're one of 2 names being considered." And he said, "I just was amazed, but I got the ticket." He said, "I started down." And he said, "Before I arrived on campus, the other person had withdrawn their name." And he said, "I was the last name." He was elected unanimously. And he said, "Paul, I can't believe this has happened." You know, friends, in the last 2 years, my life took a crazy turn. My world was totally shattered. And God came and started putting the pieces back together. And ever since that time, I have developed a deep and profound respect for the providence of God. He makes no mistakes. He knows what he's doing. And he's up to something at Hope Sound. And I couldn't be more excited about the future. God has blessed us financially. We've had a substantial surplus this year. Now, that doesn't mean we don't still need your help with the offering, because gas prices are crazy. But I just thank God. We have the highest number of applications for this fall that I remember in my 27 years at Hope Sound. That is joy. God is meeting our staffing needs. God is supplying so many needs on our campus. It just thrills me. And you know what thrills me is that this is nothing new. God has been doing this for years. Some of you went to Hope Sound. Raise your hand if you're a Hope Sound alumnus. Look at all of those. Stand up. Hope Sound alumni, go ahead and stand up. Give them a big hand. Look at that. That surprised me. I didn't realize there were that many of you all here. I love that. Four churches in this area are pastored by Hope Sound alumni. I love that. You know, I was looking at our roster for choir tour this year, and all of a sudden it dawned on me. Over two-thirds of the churches where we will be on choir tour are pastored by Hope Sound alumni. I love that. Not because we're anything special, not because we're the only ones doing it right, but we get to have a little part in God's kingdom. And it has touched your life. It has touched your community. It has touched your church. And I love that. Friends, God is in charge. God is going to win. And we get the awesome privilege of having a little part in His mighty kingdom. Hallelujah. God bless you all. Stop by the booth on the way out. We'd love to talk to you, especially if you're a prospective student. Maybe you're an alumnus. Maybe you're someone who has supported Hope Sound over the years. Maybe you'd like to know more about it. We'd love to talk to you. God bless you. Thank you to all of your pastors, and particularly Pastor Heath, one of my dear friends. We sat in his office, and I almost even didn't even get to church on time because we were catching up. But anyhow, it's so good to be here. God bless you all. Continue to worship with us. Redeemed is going to come and sing, and as they sing, the choir is going to come back to the platform. God bless you.
Your space, heaven is a wonderful place. truth and the power of that song tonight, that whatever you need him to be, that's exactly what he'll be for you this evening, if you let him. And
it's an honor and privilege
to be home in North Carolina.
There's something about it.
And, we don't get to be home very much often anymore, but that's a joy to be home. And this next song that we're getting ready to sing is a song that excites me because we're singing about the blood of Jesus. It's the great dividing line between death and life more abundantly. It's the blood of Jesus that saves and sanctifies and purifies. It's the blood of Jesus that penetrates. It's the blood of Jesus that convicts, that draws. It's the blood of Jesus that on the cross over 2,000 years ago was shed for you and for me. When he was hanging on the cross, we were on his mind tonight. It's the blood of Jesus that made all that possible for us tonight. Every single one of us has so much to be thankful for the blood of Jesus tonight. It's always been the blood, it is the blood, and it's going to be the blood for the rest of eternity. And tonight, I'm just asking that you would worship with us as we sing about the blood of Jesus.
Thank you. Man of sorrows, what a name for the Son of God who came, ruined sinners to reclaim. Hallelujah, what a Savior.
Wearing shame and scoffing wound, in my place condemned he stood, sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah, what a Savior.
Guilty, pardoned, helpless
we, spotless Lamb of God was he, full atonement can it be.
There is more to see than with my Thank you. Just getting my instructions there for a moment. Oh, thank you, choir, for sharing with us tonight. And I hope we were as exciting to sing to as you were exciting to watch and worship. And we're worshiping the God who is in control no matter what's happening in our world today. And so thank you so much for, this is the beginning of your choir tour, right? And so we need to pray for them as they travel. And pray that the fuel prices go down. That would be great, right? And pray that God will give them a wonderful time as they travel and bless people. And sing about the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And thank you, Brother Ryan, for directing all of that. It's been good to have them here. When we stood, those of us that are from Hope Sound, Paul, I was shocked as well. I didn't know so many graduates and alumni of Hope Sound are in this area. But it's good to know that God is still working in the hearts and lives of young people and calling them into ministry. And so young people, keep doing what God has called you to do. And we want to encourage you in that. Let me mention to you, the good news is we are going to receive an offering. The bad news for Hope Sound is we haven't taken up an offering in 2 years. So on the way out, this is how we've been doing it. On the way out, there is a donation basket. And if you're not from Faith Community Chapel, you may not be accustomed to that, or maybe you are. Maybe your church did that in COVID as well. But we liked it so much, we just keep on doing it that way. On the way out, there's a donation basket. I want you to dig deep. I want you to give generously. I want you to give to these young people as they travel and as they minister. And I want a good good offering here tonight to be given to Hope Sound Bible College and for this trip. And so I know you'll do well, and the donation basket is on your way out. I believe there is a final closing song. I believe the quartet's going to sing. So I want you to show your appreciation to these young people one more time. Give them a round of applause as they come back.
Goodbye, world, goodbye. Safe from the day.